discuss. Let's start with you, Maria Caulfield. Let's pick up on social care. Do you think we've seen the end of the social care policy now?
Well, I certainly welcome a discussion and consultation which is in the manifesto, because we've been debating that in Parliament since I got elected 2 years ago, and the current system isn't working. And you know, when it was set up, healthcare was set up separately to social care, and that's not working right now. So I desperately want a cross-party discussion about how we go forward. I'm not necessarily supportive of what was in our manifesto. I don't think that's the solution, but we have come to a point where the current system isn't working and we need some other solutions on the table.
As you say, this has been discussed for years. It sounds like you think it was a policy that was badly handled, but the principle was good. What's the answer? Some kind of, I know you don't like the phrase, but some kind of death tax?
Not necessarily. I think we need to be bringing healthcare and social care together, because there's a lot of duplication of services that aren't necessarily the best value for money, but also aren't providing the sort of standard of care that residents expect. And so for me, until those services are brought together and healthcare and local authorities are working together, commissioning together, I think, you know, we won't necessarily have a solution. So for me, that's the answer, rather than raising extra money through the sale of people's houses.
That's interesting. That was a UKIP policy. It was in their manifesto in the election.
I think all parties have talked about it. We actually need to start delivering on that now.
And Lloyd Russell Moore, Labour actually weren't offering to solve this long-standing issue, in fact, a crisis in social care funding. You were just offering to increase funding, but no one was saying that was going to be the answer to the problem.
No, I don't think that's quite true. I think that we were talking about integrating healthcare and social care into an NHS that was there for the cradle to the grave. It was about making sure that the funding went along with that. And I think that that's what we will be putting down in Parliament going forward with amendments to the Queen's Speech.
I don't remember you talking about an integrated model along the lines that Maria just answered. You were talking about increasing taxes to pay, taking money from the wealthy, in theory anyway, to pay for more money into the health. But no one thought, that was enough, and B, no one thought you were going to necessarily get that money from the wealthy.
You have to do both. There is no point in just saying that you're going to suddenly have some efficiency savings and merge healthcare and social care, and that's going to be the solution. So Maria is halfway there. The second part of that is that you need to increase the resources to it. And many independent studies have said that. And I actually think most of the parties are on a similar page. We agree that we need more money into health and social care as a whole overall.
But you would have been happy for wealthy pensioners to keep their assets, to keep the winter fuel allowance, for example, which actually the Conservatives were offering to address what many people see as an inequality in the system.
They pay higher tax rates, and they pay it back in a proportional way. You can either move to a system where you have so many bureaucrats worrying about paper form filling in on means testing, or what you do is you have a simple and clear taxation system where the rich pay more and the poor, of course, pay proportionally less, but they all pay a fair share, and therefore you fund it fairly, and you fund it actually onto where it needs to go, health and social care. Or you have a load of clipboard carriers who are working out whether you deserve this or you don't deserve it.
There's lots to discuss. Maria, in general, the Conservatives didn't promise anything to the older voters. They didn't promise anything to young voters either. That was a huge miscalculation, wasn't it?
Well, I think there's an agreement in the manifesto, didn't address people's concerns. And some of the work that was in the manifesto was good, but it wasn't clear enough. So, for example, when we said we'd mean test the winter fuel allowance, we didn't give enough detail. So people who are, you know, wouldn't be means tested were actually worrying, did that mean that affected them?
So where do we go from here? What do you need to offer more to younger voters now? And maybe reassurance to older ones as well?
Well, also, I don't think we sold enough about our achievements. You know, the fact that we've taken, millions of people out of paying taxation, the lowest paid out of taxation completely, the fact that we've got record levels of employment, the fact that the economy is doing well. We didn't sell that to people as our track record.
So no change in policies, no new policies to attract younger voters, voters who, as we saw in Barney Keith, went to Labour?
I think that is attractive to younger voters. For those people who are going into work for the first time, who are often in the lowest paid category, you know, the fact that we'd be able to increase that tax threshold higher so that they're less likely to be paying tax should be attractive to younger voters. You know, the childcare offering that we have on the table, 30 hours free childcare, should be attractive to younger voters. And I don't think we sold it well enough, and I think that was the issue.
Didn't sell it well enough. I think that very often it was too kind of wonky. And actually, that was the problem with the Labour manifesto, if there's any criticism, in 2015. It was too much about, we'll save you a bit of tax here, we'll save you, but there was no vision. And actually, where the Labour manifesto was, I think, really won the day.
Well, it didn't win.
It did in my area. It did in terms of it's the first time Labour has ever picked up seats since 1997, where it won the momentum and the direction of travel.
You won, but Jeremy Corbyn isn't in government.
It sold a vision of how we can do things differently.
Interesting, Lloyd. Last week we heard from a very angry voter in Canterbury who said Labour offered sweeties to young voters, for example, with the tuition fees abolition. I mean, is it responsible to promise people things that actually, according to the IFS, you were going to be able to deliver?
No, the IFS didn't say that. The IFS said that we had been overestimated on some of our income lines, but of course we had put a contingency in all of them, because that's what you do if you're a responsible budgeter, you put contingency in. And all of that could be made up with the contingency, according to the IFS.
We were the only ones. The IFS said that actually there was no guarantee the wealthy would pay the taxes. They estimated it slightly less.
Right. But we still put a contingency into account for that.
A quick word about Brexit. It was supposed to be the Brexit election. Maria Caulfield, do you think we're going to see a softer Brexit now? Talk's about to start.
Well, I think we probably will, is my honest assessment.
That.
Well, I mean, on the doorstep, I have to say, Brexit, I could count on one hand the number of conversations I had about Brexit. For me, this election was about local issues. So it was about schools, it was about infrastructure.
So another miscalculation by Theresa May, who told us it was going to be the Brexit election.
People
aren't that bothered about it.
Well, I think people have moved on. I think people accept that whether they voted Leave or Remain, accept it will happen. And what they're interested actually is what's affecting them on a day-to-day basis. And I think certainly that's what I heard on the doorstep when I was door knocking.
And Lloyd, criticism of Labour, Jeremy Corbyn has done nothing to help you this morning on the airwaves. People are very confused about where you stand and how you differ to the Conservatives on Brexit. That's a problem for you, isn't it?
No, where we differ is we don't believe that no deal is an option. We believe that we need to go in there with open hands. We need to work with our European partners and get a good deal, because a good deal for Britain is a good deal for Europe.
But in terms of single market, customs union membership, we hear one thing from one front bench or another thing from your leader. No one's very sure where you are and how you differ.
The manifesto said, and what I stood for, was that we remain access to the single market, that we, of course, will probably have to have some contribution to get into that access. You don't get into any club without paying some contribution, whether it's the golf club or the local gym or the EU. But you'll maybe pay a different fee tariff because we won't be full members, and that's very clear.
We're going to leave it there.